Good morning once again. I feel privileged and take this opportunity to welcome our Honorable DG and Secretary Dare, Dr. Trilochan Mahapatraji. I am also happy to share with you, it is my bounden duty to share with you that the support this university received since its inception in 2014, I recall he was the first orator during our first convocation, and the support we received over the years. Sir, thank you very much, sir, for all the support, mentoring during the last 7-8 years, and whatever the university that is today has been your one of your vision. Because of any new university, you have helped us. Thank you very much, sir, for that, all that support, for the new KV case, for the sanctions that we received, for the mentoring, for the ACRIPS teams, funding and everything, sir. I also take this opportunity on behalf of Indian Society of Agronomy and all its executive committee and all the students of this university, all the members of this agronomic society in inviting you and also welcoming you to this one of the prestigious societies of the country, which has contributed immensely to the development of agriculture in the country. And wish that all of you give him a big hand.
It is an honor for me to invite our chairman of today's inaugural event, Professor Trilochan Mahapatra, Secretary Dare and DG ICAR and President NAS, to address the gathering.
Thank you very much, Dr. Punjab Singh, Chancellor of RLBCAU, earlier Director General of ICAR and then Secretary Dare, Dr. Praveen Rao, President of Indian Society of Agronomy, Vice Chancellor of the prestigious university, Dr. P.V. Varaprasad, President of Crop Science Society of America, Professor Samundar Singh, President, International Wheat Science Society, Brazil, Dr. V.K. Singh, and various other delegates, very senior colleagues, colleagues from guests from many countries, more than 20 countries, I am told, are linked to this program, and also many of those physically attending, as it has said, more than 600 of them. So on my own behalf, I extend a very hearty welcome to each one of you, this International Agronomy Congress. This is my pleasure and privilege to be associated today with this particular Congress. Thanks to Dr. Praveen Rao and also Dr. V.K. Singh for inviting me to be part of this Congress. I also express my sincere thanks to Dr. Punjab Singh for insisting that I have to be here. In fact, there was another engagement. I had to find time. Agronomy is important. Agriculture and agronomy cannot be separated out, as it was, as it has been perceived, that is, as it has been derived. India has been doing quite well. Dr. Punjab Singh has given a lot of information on that. At India's performance in the agricultural sector has been fairly well, despite the limitations of COVID. We have enough production provide the free food to more than 80 crore people during COVID. We have enough stock to feed billions of people. We are feeding 1.3 billion plus, and also exporting. Our balance of trade in agriculture has very significantly improved. That was from $14.51 billion in 1920 to $20.58 billion in 2021. and that is more than 40% increase. So we are exporting not only the spices, the traditional ones, and the other horticultural crops, but importantly, we have done pretty well in cereals, particularly wheat, and even sugarcane, cotton, and of course basmati rice, which has been again the traditional one. The basmati, non-basmati export crossing more than 60,000 crore rupees is again something which is quite encouraging for us, that we have gone beyond Thailand, which was number one exporter of rice. Fresh vegetables increasing, export is increasing, sugar export is very encouraging. We had a production of about 24, 25 million tons of sugar per year, and that was barely sufficient to feed the population here and meet the demands. And some years we were importing. Introduction of a new variety, CO238, revolutionized sugar production in the country, by way of enhanced productivity per hectare productivity and enhanced sugar recovery to the tune of 12% in a state like UP. In the process, we have been able to produce 6 to 9 million tons extra. So that extra production not only encouraging export, allowed export, at the same time, this extra production has greatly facilitated diversion of sugarcane juice and sugar for bioethanol production. Bioethanol is important for substituting petroleum products that we are using, particularly petrol and diesel. And substitution of petrol to the tune of 20% is the target of the government of India. So we are moving in that direction. We are spending huge amount of money, and certainly the bioethanol production, not only from sugarcane, for various other sources, would greatly facilitate that. Food grain production, if you compare with 1950-51, we have been able to increase more than six times and crossing 308 million tons mark last year, despite COVID. So our farmers have toiled hard, our technologies have gone to the field, the government policies are all enabling higher production with higher productivity. The management systems are improving, and that is how we are able to produce more food grains. Not only more food grains, even pulses. There was a pulse revolution. We have been able to again produce more than 6 million tons additional pulses. In the process, we have reduced our import dependence, reduced our import dependence, and have gone for import substitution, almost 50% of import substitution happening. Again, that is import. There is also export happening, and we have to really look at it more critically. How do we address complete requirements of the pulses? And similarly, oil seeds. Oil seeds are more, the oil requirement is increasing, and it's a very challenging area for us. We are importing and spending a huge amount of money on oil, edible oil import, and particularly the palm oil. So about 15 million tons of oil, edible oil, we are importing and spending more than 75,000 crore rupees. And that remains one area of concern. Though in pulses we have done well, improved, a lot more need to be done in the arena of oil seed production. And we are actually, government is actually bringing out new policy schemes to address this. The milk production has increased more than 11 times, the fish production more than 12 times as compared to 1950-51. Horticulture production reaching 328 million tons mark, So, and other sectors, egg production and, you know, other production, cotton, sugarcane, and every sphere. So, so the country has done fairly well, not only managing this huge population by way of providing food, but also, you know, exporting and earning foreign exchange to the tune of, you know, 41, 42 billion US dollar. So when we say that we are coming well, but we are not losing sight of the sustainable food system needs in terms of the water, in terms of energy, in terms of soil and other natural resources, so we are quite concerned about it. The global you know, efforts which are being made in this direction, we are analyzing and also at the same time taking note of global developments to build programs here and the policies here so that our agricultural production system is far more sustainable and we are able to you know, continue providing adequate food and also more importantly nutrition to our population. The nutrition front, we have been lagging behind and a whole lot required to be done. And I'm sure our dietary diversity system, which was existing earlier, needs to be brought back quicker and in the process address the malnutrition. The developments in recent times have led us to consume less diverse foods. The culinary diversity, what Honorable M.S. Swaminathan, the father of Indian agriculture, you know, emphasizes on, needs to be really looked at critically. So that we are doing and we'll continue doing that. But coming back to the subject agronomy, I think we need to really do a lot more. We had Green Revolution, and many of you, all of you rather know that we had Green Revolution. Green Revolution certainly was the result of introduction of very high-yielding semi-dwarf varieties in wheat in particular and also in rice. So this yield jumps that we realized in wheat and in rice, it's not just because we had semi-dwarfing types, but also we have improved agronomy. Improved agronomy enabled higher productivity. And that situation doesn't really stop there, need not stop there, and would not stop there anyway. The enhanced productivity, as we analyzed our gaps, yield gaps, you know, due to a gap in production potential, whatever, you know, we have seen in terms of yield ceiling, that needs to be really broken and newer technologies and then existing technologies, amalgamation of both are being attempted to actually break the yield ceiling. While that is going on one side, the other side, what is quite visible is the agronomy gap or management gap. And that management gap is tremendous. If I have to cite an example, the wheat productivity per hectare productivity in case of Punjab is 5 tons per hectare. In case of Chhattisgarh, it is just 1.3 tons per hectare. So that's the kind of a gap that we see, the microclimate, the agroecology, and the management all making a big difference with regard to wheat productivity. So also cotton. We see the cotton productivity in case of Maharashtra, the largest producing state where maximum cotton is produced with a maximum area. And there the productivity is so low, it's not even 260 or 270 kg lint per hectare. But if you compare with Punjab, you know, this goes up to 700 kg lint per hectare. So that's a wide gap, and this is the management gap, and I believe that is a strong case for agronomy to play its part and then address this gap. This needs a critical analysis. Whether we have International Agronomy Congress or national deliberations and discussions, we need to really delve deeper and gain deeper insight into what is really happening. There are many things quite obvious, and reasons are quite visible, and that's what our prime concern, that how do we fix these gaps, or we go for crop diversification and in the process enable more returns to the farmers. As a result, the country also gains. There are deficiencies in certain areas, as I said, pulses and oil seeds, and how we actually go for crop substitution. So crop planning is so important. So agronomist has to really deal with this. Appropriate crop plans, implementation of those crop plans, in addition to other management practices, would go a long way in some of these needs and issues and concerns which are there in the country. Of course, when I say the agronomy, obviously we have been dealing with seed rate, and we need high density planting in certain crops, say cotton, for instance. When you talk of high density planting, we need to have appropriate agronomy in place. And obviously we need to really work for that. We do not have that kind of agronomy worked out in many situations. So international developments and national work and our work plans and schemes, all that need to be taken into account and learn from experiences from elsewhere. High density planting of cotton is known elsewhere, and we need to really design this. Green revolution, which was enabled, as I said, because of management, because of agronomy, in addition to new plant types and the high yielding varieties which were entered. And today, we have a large number of technologies, and we can also develop and advise technology developers, particularly plant breeders, based on what is actually required with respect of management and agronomy for realizing higher productivity. And can that feedback reach the plant breeders' desk so that they also redesign, reframe, and re-strategize their work and the process, deliver on what is actually required based on the advice received. So there is a kind of a reverse mechanism that must operate, effectively, so that we give back to the nation and also to the world a better, yields, higher productivity, and more return to the farmers. Small and marginal farmers need that. And in the context of issues, what Dr. Punjab Singh highlighted, the water use efficiency, nutrient use efficiencies, and all that, how do we really make it up and then make more efficient our production system? In the process, make them more sustainable. So sustainable food systems, only we talk about, certainly the natural resource base has to be preserved. So how do we really preserve the natural resource base? Today we talk of precision agricultural systems. Water to be applied whenever it is required, and the quantity, the crops require, depending on the soils, depending on the region, depending on the crop needs, evapotranspiration, and so on and so forth, and so also the nutrient. The amount of nutrient required at the right time, it needs to be really applied. And the right format of application, whether it is fertigation systems or sprays and using modern tools and including drones and whatever, precision agriculture tools are available. We started with laser labeling. It has not really picked up so much. We have a whole lot of other tools and techniques and use of sensors and also decision support system based on the agro, particularly the weather, and the remote sensing information system. And when we take all that into account and build our precision agriculture platforms, we should be able to save on all these natural resources and make agriculture more sustainable. The cost of production would also reduce. Mention was made that agriculture has become far more non-remunerative. How do we make agriculture more remunerative? Honorable Prime Minister has given the call, and all of us know that we have to double and triple the income of the farmers. How do we really double or go beyond doubling the farmers' income unless we reduce the input costs and cost of production? And the agronomist can better serve this particular area, and if we can reduce the cost of production very efficiently by way of the management and the process, enhance the farmers' income. I believe, you know, this is the era we have nano urea now has gone to the field, and how many more such technologies we can provide, which would be part of our precision agriculture system. The micro irrigation is expanding, but then there are a lot of issues in that system of management, and agronomists can play a very important role in providing solutions in that aspect. Dr. Punjab Singh did mention about resource conservation technology, conservation agriculture practices. The way we used to understand soil system and the way we used to go for practices like deep plowing. And today those concepts have changed, and we are now, you know, have different recommendations in terms of zero tillage or minimum tillage and weed management by way of having those mulches. So many various other things which we are practicing today, quite a changed agronomy, very different agronomy which we are practicing today. But then the rapid promotion of those agronomy and detailing of the science and evidences behind agronomy needs to be really worked out. And quicker we do, better would be our service to the nation. And I'm sure when we talk of all these, there will be a lot of sessions. I was looking at quite elaborate planning in the Congress. A lot of deliberations will be happening. And I'm sure we'll be able to address all these. The chemical use needs to be really reduced. Honorable Prime Minister has given the call that we have to reduce chemical use by 15-20% at least. How do we really promote this? In the form of biofertilizer, in the form of other management practices, use of nano, and by way of other practices, and bio agents to be utilized in our management. How do we really do more and more such things and defining organic practices as much as possible? We have developed more than 50 organic practices for different crops and cropping systems and taking them to the field, but then building further onto this, the science behind this, so that we have sufficient evidences to support the organic production system. Unless we have evidences, we will not be able to really promote. Today, the call is to promote natural farming systems. And can we, and to what extent, and under which circumstances, what are the niche areas where the natural farming systems can be really promoted? There is a big role of agronomy to really play there. And I'm sure you'd be all discussing those and then giving us recommendations to actually take it to the policy level interventions, or even program level intervention or investment level interventions adequately to serve the farmers better and country better. There are many other areas. We have soils which are problem soils. And how do we really solve those problem soils by better agronomy? I'm sure you'd be deliberating those, whether they're heavy metals, acid soils, or saline soils. So obviously agronomy along with soil science would be playing very, very significant role, and issues, concerns thereof can be addressed by you, the learned agronomists who are present today. Then where agronomy stands in the today's context of soil-less agriculture, the soil-less agriculture, as the agronomy was defined, and you know very much, it deals with field crop production. And it has to deal with horticulture crop production. And obviously it is already doing that. And agronomy of horticulture crops and how much we have worked out and in what situation we have worked out. Nitrogen use efficiency in horticulture crops, or for that matter, other nutrient use efficiencies. They are not to be really left to the nature to actually harvest whatever they can from the soil system. Or from environment, we have to really bother, particularly the perennials. The perennial systems need greater attention of ours. To what extent we need to really work out more. And similarly, when we talk of management of soil management as part of agronomy, the soil-less cultures today are very much there and reality. The hydroponics and other systems, the aeroponics, which you are actually using. They are all soil-less systems. And in soil-less systems, what is that we need to really do in terms of agronomic practices? Whether agronomy stands there or we need to really redefine agronomy in the context of new developments. You are all learned agronomists present there. I'm sure you'll be actually deliberating this, and how do we revisit the definition of agronomy and then reposition ourselves in the context of new developments nationally and globally, and so that we remain relevant and continue to be relevant as we go along. Nutrition is a major issue, as I said earlier, and in this country, we have a huge number of population who are actually having deficiencies, some or other deficiencies. And how do we actually address that? We are going for, as I said, a dietary diversification, and the portion of region of this country is trying to address those. But that is one aspect. We are also developing biofortified crop varieties. Biofortified crop varieties require proper agronomy so that the crops are actually fortified with the desired traits and desired elements that we need, whether zinc or iron or whatever, or vitamin A or right kind of amino acids. So at the same time, agronomic fortification is also very, very important. Even if we have the normal crop varieties, they are also deficient. The soil system is deficient. In the context of one health, we need to really address soil deficiencies. And there comes the role of agronomy. And I believe you'll be discussing all these at length. And how do we really address the deficient soil system and degraded soil system, the land degradation in this country, more than 97 million hectares being degraded out of 140, 42 million hectares of area. And how do we really address by proper agronomy the land degradation? So a whole lot of issues are there. The carbon content is declining. We thought that we are doing a pretty good job in the Indo-Gangetic plain, and that's our food bubble. And rice wheat system, we continued. And there was actually a consortium to look at it. But then we lost out somewhere, and the organic carbon content went down in many areas. And this needs to be really addressed. And what kind of agronomy? The crop residues should be plowed back to the field. The agronomy has been actually worked out for this system in case of Punjab. And incorporation of crop residues certainly contributed very significantly for improving soil fertility and soil organic carbon. But the adoption of these technologies is an issue. The social issues and or the economic issues are always important. And agronomy cannot really, or management cannot go in isolation. So we need to really address those. At global level, the new developments need to be really capitalized on. And I believe our colleagues from USA and other countries will be providing insights and deeper insights in areas where we would be actually lagging behind. Building partnerships would be very, very rewarding. I believe colleagues from USA who have been a part of this country, born or brought up here, certainly would be happy to contribute to developments in this area by way of capacity building, by way of research, new research dimensions getting added to address some of those issues and concerns and gaps which are existing. So I'm sure this particular conference will be a great success. I wish all the very best to this Congress. And at the end, I thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to be here and to take part in the Congress. And thank you very much, and wish you all the very best.